Yeah, I mean, it is a big responsibility. You're absolutely right, and so we did lots of research and met with experts to make sure that we were saying the right things, the rewards are really really fantastic. Apart from coming here tonight and everything, it's just being able to see something on TV that you don't normally see, to go inside someone's mind in a different way, to portray someone on their own in their bedroom and what their kind of dark, quiet moments are like. I mean, that was just, a joy to get to do that, really.
Pleased are you to see some of the cast, particularly Jack, nominated on his own here tonight?
Oh, I think it's fantastic. I'm so proud of him, even though, you know, I'm not his mum or anything, but I just think it's brilliant. He did such a good job, and he's such a lovely man as well. I don't want to say boy or man, but he's brilliant, and I think he totally deserves it. He brought a lot of his own things to the character, and he did loads of research, and yeah, I think he's fantastic. I'm sure he's going to keep going on and on and on. In general, I feel really proud to be one of the people that's getting to do it, and you know, I think that, you know, you hope that other people think, well, I can do it too, and if they want to, and it's a shame there aren't more, but maybe this is the start of that. You know, I don't mean me, I just mean, you know, in general, this whole movement is maybe the start of that.
Do you think there are reasons why there is such a big gap in the number of male and female writers that we see, particularly on television?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know why that is. I mean, I think that, yeah, I think there's... I think when you switch on the TV, there's more men on TV than women. When there were four channels, I remember somebody saying to me, if you flip between them at any time, three of the faces you'll see will be men. I think as an actor, I've found that there's more roles for men, because just, I think there are just more shows with men in, and men can play so many different parts. But maybe this is the start of things changing. I think people want to see more women, want to hear more women's voices, and I think maybe people think that they're going to be set, you know, that women are going to be talking, like, I don't know, romance and chick flicks and things, and really we like the dark stuff as well. So
easy to look away from difficult subjects and to forget other parts of society, and I think it's really important to bear witness to stories which are very, very difficult to tell for the general public. We wanted people who really honoured the subject matter and felt a close relationship with the material, and we mustn't forget the very brave British Pakistani actors who played the perpetrators, who brought their own knowledge and expertise of all these issues to us when we were preparing, when we were rehearsing, and they were very, very generous, weren't they, Nicole, all those people. So we felt like we were in a really big team together, all committed to telling this one story.
I feel like, for me, one of the great things about the success of Three Girls is it's given me courage to keep on writing the things that I want to write, which is stories about Britain, stories about women, and stories about women that you don't normally see on TV. So I feel like it's a really exciting moment. Three Girls was a massively female-dominated team. I wrote it, Philippa directed it, we had a female editor, all the bosses at the BBC were women, and hopefully the results sort of confirm that, you know, put us together, we'll make amazing stuff, and I feel optimistic. I think I'm still astounded that so many people watched it, because I just had my head down. We all had our head down in this for years and years and years, and my only thought really was just to do justice to the trust that the girls were placing in us, and then suddenly it's out there and everyone's talking about it, and I'm so proud of that. And what I've taken away is, don't shy away from difficult stories. Just get about them and trust the audience, because they're as curious as you are, and we're all asking the same questions. And drama can do things that journalism can't. It can make you feel things, you know, because you're just people watching people. So I feel like drama is a really hopeful medium, and Three Girls, I'm thrilled at how it's gone down. I just want to write more.
My name's Molly Windsor and I'm an actor.
Molly, it's amazing to have you here tonight, and obviously seeing Three Girls nominated in so many categories, can you talk about what it meant for you to be part of that superb piece of drama?
I think it's a huge responsibility for everyone involved, and to do the story justice. and those girls have been ignored for so long. It's about time that their voices got heard and for us to make their voices as clear and as loud as we can. Philippa is incredible. Regardless of being female, she is the most incredible director, and her vision and her strength, and she led us through Three Girls, and it's phenomenal that we were blessed with her talent. I'm in absolute awe of her. We're very lucky. I think as soon as I read the script, I just felt like I needed to tell that story. This can't be true, this can't be happening. And now that feeling won't change until we make it change and until we do something about it and start listening to people within our community.
What are you moving on to next? What have you got coming up in 2018 and beyond?
I'm about to start a feature film in Cornwall. It's one of the iFeatures new projects, so that's where my head's at the minute.
What does it mean for you to be part of this beautiful celebration of the very best of our programming?
Yeah, I've done all right out of telly as my hobby, you know. That's my hobby, really, making telly. And I've done all right, so it's fun to be part of it. You know, I'm quite proud of the fact that... It's not my day job in a way, so it was unexpected delight to be kind of welcomed into the bosom of the television community.
Someone who, like you say, is more familiar in other mediums, how do you find television? What opportunities does it present to you as a visual artist?
Huge audiences. You know, I'm doing well if I get 100,000 people coming to see one of my exhibitions. If that were my audience figures, I'd get the sack.
What else do you have coming up in 2018 and beyond? We love seeing what you create next.
Got a new series in the autumn. I'm going international and we're doing the great milestones of life, you know, birth, death and all that. Heavy stuff.
That is really big stuff to be tackling. What made you feel that this was the right time for you to be taking on those themes?
I'm a 58-year-old man and... I like tackling emotional subjects.
Well, it was a privilege to be a part of, and I think it's fair to say that everyone involved wanted to do the best they could. They wanted to tell Mel and Steve's story as best they could, honour Reese's memory. So with that in mind, there was a certain amount of pressure. You know, we were in a very fortunate position to just be pretending. You know, we got to go home at the end of the day to our kids and, you know. I think the very fact that, I mean, as you say, there have been plenty of horrible stories and dramas made around them recently, but the fact that it was a... Reese was an 11-year-old boy just coming home from football practice. It was a prime example of, you know, there but for the grace of God kind of thing. Like wrong place, wrong time, even though he wasn't in the wrong place the wrong time, those boys shouldn't have been there. And they were boys as well. The guy, you know, Sean Mercer and them carrying guns, just horrific, horrific. Stephen Graham is, you could not meet a nicer, more generous actor. And you know, they say it's like playing tennis. You want to play with someone who's so much better than you, so you have to try and, you know, meet them. And every single cast member was incredible. Amy Hubbard, who cast it, spent 3 months in Liverpool looking for, you know, all those guys who were in the gang. She did a brilliant job. Every single person was superb in the ensemble. Great. I've just had a baby, so I'm looking after him at the minute. And then who knows what will happen next. Who knows?
Charlie, it's wonderful to have you here for us tonight. I'm curious, what do you think Kerry and Curtin would make of this wonderful celebration here in the heart of London?
Oh my God, it would blow their little minds, I think. It's blowing my mind right now, so yeah, it's amazing.
Talking about amazing, this is a show that's really been a huge hit with fans and really connected with people. Why do you think these two characters have had that resonance with people?
I don't know. I mean, a lot of it is just us being ourselves, really. And I think it's just, we always try and write from an angle of truth and you know, as long as it's real, then the comedy comes after. So I guess if people, yeah, just people resonate with the truth of it, which is quite nice.
Of course, there's so many memorable lines from the show, so many memorable scenes. Is there ones in particular that you have the most fond place in your heart for?
Do you know what? Obviously, when each episode comes out, it's amazing seeing what catches on, because it's never the ones you think are going to catch on. And I think it was the third episode, Nosy Old Cockwomble, caught on quite well, which I didn't really... I thought that would sink without a trace. But yeah.
In terms of the language of the show, can you talk a little bit about that? Because it's very specific, but it's also very identifiable.
Yeah, well, that's just what we're both, me and Daisy, my sister, we're both from the Cotswolds, and that's where we were brought up, and we still live there now. So it's just, it's got quite a strong identity, but you don't realise that until you leave and you go elsewhere, and then you realise, oh, it's quite different. But yeah, it's just writing what we know, that's all it is.
Last question before you leave us, what have you got coming up the rest of the year and beyond?
Hopefully writing more this country, but we're just waiting for a green light, really, so yeah.
I'm Wumi Masaku. Hi.
It's amazing to have you here with us tonight. How does it feel to be nominated in several categories?
I feel really excited and really proud. I feel like everyone's done their best work and, yeah, they're getting the recognition that they deserve.
How inspiring is it in particular to see women nominated so heavily, particularly in the writing and directing categories this year?
If you want things to change, then they have to change from behind the scenes as well, for those kind of characters to be written and, you know, those kind of decisions to be made about, you know, crew and cast and character. I'm so glad that those people are at the top, that there are people like me, women and black women, and that's important to me, you know.
Obviously, one of the shows you're nominated for is one of our very favourite things to come out on Netflix in recent years. Can you talk a little bit about why that show has connected with so many people, you think?
I'm not really sure what why things click with people, but I do know it's... You know, we don't really have that many, like, gritty coming-of-age story kind of things, and this has got this dark... comic feel and graphic novel thing, and I don't know, there's that, I don't know, I don't really know why, it's just, it was just really well written, and those, our leads, Alex and Jessica, were just so brilliant that they made people fall in love with them.
Obviously, it's hilarious at times to watch. I'm curious, do you have a most fond memory from set for that one?
My fondest memory on set, I mean, the whole job was so great, and so Gemma and I working together every day, that was like the best. And yeah, filming in the Isle of Sheppey and the beautiful, like, it was so beautiful and it was so hot and perfect. It was just a dream job. We had an ice cream van come to set on our last day. That was brilliant.
What does it mean for you to be part of this specific celebration of programming?
I've no idea what anything means in this stupid life. So I'm the worst person to answer that sort of question. I've got no idea. Oh, it's nice. It's nice to be here. It's nice to be out of the house. It makes a change, doesn't it?
Talking about nice, it was fantastic news for fans that we are getting another series of Black Mirror, of course, on Netflix. How excited are you to continue that partnership with Netflix and to have another batch of odd tales for us?
It's good. That's a good feeling. It's a good problem to have, that we've got to do another bunch of them. We're working on them now, and we've been working on them for a little while. So it's good. They've been very good to us. I can't complain about that. Yeah.
Having done quite a few series now, you've explored a lot of different themes. Like you say, it's a good problem to have, but is it hard to find new stories that don't tread on similar ground to some of the stuff you've already done? Because there's been a lot of interesting stuff so far.
Yeah, I mean, it's a challenge. It's definitely a challenge to kind of keep reinventing the show with each episode. But hopefully, judging by the stuff we're working on so far for the next season, I think we've managed to continue keeping things fresh and interesting and appalling in just the right measure, I hope.
Is that important for you, that people have a very visceral response to the show?
Well, yeah, because otherwise, what's the point? I mean, if you're going to waste people's time on the magic rectangle, you might as well you might as well give them something to remember, I guess. Hopefully, we always try and provoke some sort of reaction, even if that's unbridled vomiting.
Obviously, the last series in particular had a host of very recognisable faces. Is that also going to be the case for season 5 then?
I think so, yes. I can't confirm or deny anything yet, but there's certainly some people that I've seen that I go, oh, I know them. So, yes, I think in a roundabout way, yes.
Before you leave us to enjoy yourself tonight, do you have a message for all the Black Mirror fans, people who love and support the show and have helped it along its way?
Have I got a message for them? Don't stop watching the programme, you bastards. I don't know, yeah.
This is what I love about Britain. You guys do a good awards ceremony. We have maybe two in Australia. We have the Logie Awards for TV, we have the AFI Awards, now called the Actor Awards, for TV and film. And that's it. You guys have the RTS, the Broadcast Awards, the BAFTAs, the Trick Awards. I love that you celebrate performance and you celebrate television. And it's, you know, I mean, sure, we get lots of attention, but it's nice to, I don't know, it's nice to have a night like this and realise that, you know, there are people watching and they do enjoy what you do.
I think obviously people love comedy, but I think what's also really important about comedy is that so often it is the primary vehicle by which, as a society, we address and tackle themes that we don't actually seem to confront in other ways. Can you talk a little bit about that aspect of comedy, that ability that it has?
Well, we've accidentally fallen into becoming a satirical news show. And over the last 12 months in particular, we've had to cover things like the Westminster attack, the Manchester attack, Grenfell, as well as silly and ridiculous stories. And I think people developed a sense of humour as, you know, way, way, way back to deal with tragedy, to deal with harsh things in life. So it's a coping mechanism. And I think maybe that's what we're here for. I've got heaps on at the moment. I've joined a disability rugby league team in Warrington. So I'm missing training tonight. I'm supposed to be in Warrington training with my team tonight, and I had to get dispensation to come away. We're trying to turn that into a documentary. I've got a book coming out this year, like a kind of autobiography that's coming out in July, and The Last Leg. So that's kind of, that's my 2018. A book, a documentary, rugby league, and The Last Leg.
In terms of that book, I mean, what do you think is going to surprise people most about your life story? People who maybe feel they already have a handle on who you are and what you represent?
I think probably when they realise how long I've been doing comedy. Like when there are stories in that book when I started doing comedy from nearly 30 years ago. So I think just the longevity and their utter persistence. I think it's going to surprise people how long it took me to make it.
How does it feel to be part of this very glamorous celebration of British programming here tonight?
Yeah, good. No, sick. Very, very ecstatic. Yeah, I look like a flight attendant tonight. That's the sort of swag I've gone for. Yeah. How about you?
I squirted.
You squirted?
Yeah.
It's gone for Russian Baron. Yes. You?
I've gone sort of minimal effort,
minimal
really.
Minimal
yeah,
tech.
Minimal tech.
Egg.
Yeah. German tech response. Sort of vibes.
German tech.
Yeah.
Good job.
Yeah.
To be honest, it's just like a bunch of friends having fun. That's how it came about, and hopefully that speaks for itself, I guess.
The show is a whole lot of fun to watch. Is it fun to make? What's the atmosphere like on set when you guys are making this magic?
Yeah, it's amazing. It's just we don't take it very seriously. It's all a bit of a joke a lot of the time. And we spend a lot of time writing it, and then we get onto set, and we're prepared, and then we mess around loads. So it works, I think.
Who messes around the most? Who's the real troublemaker? Name names, shame people.
I'd say this man.
Yeah.
He's got absolutely no respect for anyone. So, yeah.
True.
And that's what I love about him.
Yeah, that's really, and I'm a bit of a vibe creator, so that's it.
I just think it's such a thrill to be nominated and for all of us to be here and have sort of just to give ourselves a night out from working in Halifax on the cobbled streets is a great thing. But we're also really missing the cast who aren't with us tonight, who are all valiantly working away and doing the real stuff. We're out having a glamorous night out, but we're so thrilled to be nominated against The Crown and the end of the f***ing world. So that's a great thing, and we would never have expected to be here. So thanks for having us.
There's nothing like it on TV right now, and there hasn't been for a long time. So
I mean, not to blow our own trumpet, but it's pretty groundbreaking. So I think, and that's why we're up against shows like The Crown and The End of the F***ing World.
It's a fun.
Make sure that I get that word perfect. And I feel really bad saying the word f***ing as well.
No, we know that there's a complete lack of diversity in many aspects of television. I think Ackley Bridge has really embraced that, where diversity is really important to it, but it's not the overpowering thing either. Some great stories. The writers have worked really hard on this, and I think it's a really important show, and it's bringing a young audience to Channel 4, you know, and television, you know, terrestrial television desperately needs young people watching again, and I think this show is trying to do that, and it's doing it really well.
I think the word diversity is one that we continue to debate. Do you feel that that is a word that we are embracing more? Is our screen more diverse than it was 10 years ago, 20 years ago?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's becoming, you know, something that's not just a policy, but something that's really important and vital for the future of television and film everywhere, really. And I'm glad that Ackley Bridge is sort of leading the way of that on terrestrial TV.
Oh, we're just so excited. I mean, it's just so wonderful to be able to bring this story that we all love so much. And we did, obviously, we performed on the stage for so many years. To bring it to the BBC and then to be, I guess, honoured in this way is just, it's really touching. It's really fantastic. I'm so pleased that people seem to love what we offered with love.
Obviously, like you say, this is a story that you've lived with for quite some time. Yeah. I'm curious, it means a lot to audiences. What has it most meant to you, though?
Well, I think, you know, one of the great things about theatre is that you get to be part of a family. You know, we worked all together as our royal family for 2.5-3 years. And, you know, we've got the incredible Tim Pigott-Smith as our patriarch. He's so sorely missed. I can't even begin to express, you know, how we all feel about him not being able to celebrate with us tonight. But to be able to bring that family, when we filmed it, you know, to the wider world, and to bring this incredible story that Mike Butler has written to the wider world, it was just a huge honour for us. So we're so pleased, yeah.
For people who aren't familiar, can you explain to us what these badges are and why it's so important to be wearing them? Charlotte?
Do you know what? I think actually it's really more interesting if Ollie explains that rather than having a woman explain it.
Yeah, we're here as 50-50, so as one half of the 50. I'll take on the responsibility. And I think it's important because this is not a movement, this is not a women's movement, this is a society movement, and this is about both genders coming together to form a balanced representation. Obviously, ERA 50-50 stands for Equal Representation for Actresses. And what we're hoping to achieve is gender parity on screen. It's as simple as that. And we hope that gender parity on screen will... We're hoping that gender parity on screen will stimulate more female stories being told, which is more female writers, which is more female directors, more female producers, more female... Just a better balance throughout the industry. And obviously, as actors, we approach this from, you know, our representation on the screen, and we hope that filters back through. It's just a phenomenal movement, and I think like in these times, you know, there is a revolution happening, and I think it's just bizarre that we don't have equal representation on our screens. I think the numbers shake down as for adult TV, there's 2 men for every woman. And in children's TV, yeah, I think there's 3 men for every woman. Yeah. You know, this isn't the world we live in. And I just think it's time that we, you know, kind of made our entertainment more representative of the world we live in.
We're talking about, obviously, the wonderful progress that is being made. But why do you think those barriers, why do you think those gaps still exist in 2018 in the first place?
Good question. Don't know the answer to that. Why do they still exist? I literally don't know the answer to that. Because it's really sad times that they do still exist, yeah.
In terms of the concrete steps that people are taking, we've obviously seen particularly Frances McDormand championing inclusion riders. Do you think that's the kind of concrete steps that people can take that will change, finally, that imbalance?
Yeah, I think there's, you know, the solution-based... movements that are happening all the time. There's brilliant groups of people like these guys, like us guys.
Well, you're championing, you know, extra childcare.
Yeah,
on sets, which
yeah.
Is
I'm working on a project at the moment called Ready Set Play, which is providing childcare on set so that more people can get back to work. Not just, you know, again, it's not just a women's issue. It's men and women getting back to work after becoming parents. Like, you can't talk about gender equality on screen if you don't talk about childcare. Having childcare on sets means that you all these brilliantly highly skilled people have trained incredibly hard from their teenage years to get where they are. It means that when they decide to go and have children, I'm talking about crew now, when they decide to go and have children, they can get back into the industry afterwards. And I think if we support men and women in that, then you're going to get more of an equality behind and in front of the camera.
In terms of behind the camera, obviously here tonight in particular, we've seen some fantastic women nominated both in the writing and directing categories. How important do you think it is with equal representation that it's not just on screen, but off screen that we see that change happen?
I think that's probably even, you know, obviously for me, I have my own children and I want them to be watching, you know, Ollie talked earlier about the representation of male-female characters on children's TV. I think even from those grassroots, that's really important. But I think if you're going to be having more female writers, more female directors, more female DOPs, then you're going to be getting them bringing more female stories to the fore. And I think, well, let's face it, that's what it's all about. Women, personally, I you know, I want to be playing women who are characters just being human, like not necessarily always stories that are about women's issues. You know, I've had the pleasure of working with Mike Bartlett again, who wrote the piece that we were part of, about a woman who is a journalist. And the piece is not about her being a woman in that industry. It's just about a journalist. And those are the characters as an actor. You know, that's like one in 150 scripts are like that, that you read. And it's taken me 10 years to get to the point where I can play a character that isn't necessarily always a love interest, or she's a foil, or do you know, and that's really exciting, and that's one of the reasons that I wanted to do that project. So more characters like that, and I think having more women behind the camera is going to be encouraging those characters to get on screen.
Final question: what's coming up next for both of you? Where are we going to see you next?
Just been working with Mike Bartlett again on press, just in a project called Trust with Danny Boyle, which was great fun. So yeah, and just whatever life brings, working on the Ready, Set, Play, which is the childcare for sets, so, yeah.
I've been standing behind Robert Downey Jr. in a big hat.
What have you been doing?
I'm doing some work on Dr. Doolittle, the feature that's coming out, the Universal feature coming out with Robert Downey Jr., which mostly involves me standing behind Robert Downey Jr. in a big hat. But I got a great sword, so I love it.
I mean, that's such an iconic character, an iconic story. And what can we just expect generally from this version of it?
From this version? Well, now, you know, what can I tell? Oh, that would be telling. What I do know is I don't think there is a giant snail. And I'm sad about that. But there are a menagerie of crazy creatures and animals that you'll see on the screen. We don't see any of them because they're obviously all going to be created. But apparently they're going to be amazing. Yeah, it's going to be huge.